Welcome everyone to the fourth episode of Avow's 2021 Expert Talks. Today we're going to talk about algo operations and how to scale up your algorithmic marketing. My name is Sebastian. I am the principal of analytics at Avow's. I have a bit more than 5 years of working experience in the field of data science, machine learning. I also have a background in software engineering. Together with me today, I have Martin Lennartsson. Please introduce yourself.
Yep. Hello, everyone. My name is Martin. I'm currently a delivery lead at ICA Sweden with a background as a data scientist. And also I've been working with analysis and whatever you've been calling it over the past 10 years, at least. In all different areas, from logistics up until cyber threat analysis and forensics and a lot of stuff. But currently it's ICA and I've been there for some 3 years, roughly.
Thank you. Thank you, Martin. We also have Mikael with us today. Hi, Mikael.
Hey, everyone. Mikael Montonen. Currently working as the team lead for experience orchestration team. I have a plethora track record of different MarTech solution oriented projects, as well as projects regarding different kind of architectures, especially in the IT department, as well as experience client experience architectures. So anything related to data activation, I've been working quite a long time.
Thank you. Today's agenda starts with me and my talk about operations within data and analytics. Then we will hear Mikael talk about a case from a Finnish broadcasting company. And last, but certainly not least, we will hear Martin talk about a case from ICA. So let's dive into the first talk. So I want to set the scene with a typical end-to-end use case for machine learning. So first of all, you need some data to work with. And let's say you have customer data and you have web interactions, you have app interactions, and perhaps you buy in third-party data from a third-party source. If you want to do machine learning, you would need to combine all these data sources, let's say in an analytical platform. And what you typically do is you import the raw data, and then you would try to prepare the data, you would clean it, and then you would produce some aggregates on the data so that it can be very easily usable by data scientists. Then the data scientist from the clean data would create training data sets. And this is done by calculating features on historical data. And features are data points, information points about the customer, and also about products in question in this use case. So one feature might be the spend that a customer has on a product, or the number of logins in web, or the different products they have viewed in the app. And all the features are combined into a training data set. Upon this training data set, you would then do model training. Model training is, in my opinion, a very experimentative phase where you try a lot of different models on the problem. You might train 10 or 100 different models and parameters to find the best model. And you find the best model by performing cross-validation and then evaluating all different models to find the one that performs best according to your chosen metric or metrics. I would also say that the feature engineering is experimental as well, and it can be an iterative process going from training data set and model training. But once you have found the best model, you want to save that model so that you can reuse the model for prediction in later stages. So the next stage would be to calculate the same features that you used throughout training, but instead of calculating them on a historical or historical points in time, You want to calculate how the features look for the customer right now. And on these features, you apply your saved model and you get some predictions. And in this stage, you might also want to apply some business rules so that nothing crazy happens with your models. And you also want to save the predictions of the model so that you can track the actual outcomes that you see in the future. And once you have applied business rules and you have your prediction, you want to present them in a presentable way so that all the different activation systems can access the predictions and take decisions based on the predictions. What you also want to do is you want to keep track over time of the performance of the model so that if you see a downgrade in performance or you see a serious shift in the distribution of the features, you want to re-trigger the training of a model, training data set creation and training of the model, and then save the new best model that you've found, which will perform hopefully better than the last model that downgraded over time. But it all sounds very nice, but nothing in these steps will happen magically. Every single step will need some kind of operations, whether it is manual or automatic. So you would need to import the data, you would need to prepare the data, you would need to create data sets, we need to train the models, predict with the models, present the predictions, and import them into all different activation systems. And operations, that is the topic of today. So I just want you to see what is the topic of today, and I'm going to make a case for automating all of these steps that you see here. And what I also see, which makes me die a little bit inside every time I see it, and I see it way too often, is that this is not an analytical platform, but rather this is a data scientist's laptop. So a data scientist would import data onto his laptop from all different systems, do the data prep himself manually, create features and combine them into a training data set, train different models, find the best one, do prediction, and then export the results as a file and then send it, let's say, to the email system or the web system. And this becomes a full-time job when you do it in this way. Because if you are going to produce predictions once every week or every day, a data scientist will be stuck with these operational tasks instead of being able to do new development. So then the question is, this is just an example of one model. What happens if your situation looks like this or your end goal is this? So how do you handle this? And that is the topic of today. Gartner says that most analytics and AI projects fail because operationalization is only addressed as an afterthought, and that the top barrier of scaling analytics and AI implementations is the complexity around integrating the solution with existing enterprise applications and infrastructure. And it's no surprise when the landscape looks like this, where you have lots of data points, which is then fed into multiple algorithms, which is then activated in hundreds or sometimes thousand different activation points. And this landscape is ever growing in complexity, and that creates a demand for more and more innovative solutions for operations in order to scale. But what is scale? I would simplify that term and say that scale is the ability to produce increasingly more value without having to employ an increasing amount of resources. So what happens if you deal with operations as an afterthought and not in a proactive manner? I would say that you end up in something I call the operations swamp. I'm going to take a customer comment or citation as an example. A client of mine said that we don't need a framework for operations, we have people. And this is a demonstration that not realizing your own inability to scale is really, really common among companies. So I'm going to present to you 7 different symptoms and side effects that you typically see from companies that get stuck in the operations swamp, so that you can keep an eye out for the symptoms and realize that you need to get out of the swamp. So the first symptom is that you always view operations as a future problem. I get it, you're starting with a proof of concept and you don't want to automate everything because that would take a lot of time. You just want to see, can you get some quick results with this machine learning model? But after 3 months, after 6 months, after 12 months, it's not a future problem anymore. You need to face the problem and you cannot kick the can down the road anymore. You also see a waste of talent. You employ good data scientist and data engineering talent, but they are stuck with operational tasks and they can spend basically no time on new development. I had a former colleague of mine who at his former employer was in charge of the churn model. That was his only job. He was responsible for the implementation and operations for the churn model. And he could do nothing more than that. That took up all of his time. Another symptom is that you have poor talent attrition. The same company that said, we don't need a framework for operations, we have people. They also had a problem that none of their data scientists that they employed stayed more than 1 year. Every data scientist that they employed quit within 1 year. And they failed to understand why. And I don't blame the data scientists, because if you're stuck with just running a model for 9 months straight, that would make me quit as well. The next symptom is that you're being complacent with what you have and you find it a bit uncomfortable to scale. You believe that what you have today is good enough and that you don't really need to develop. You see yourself ending up in a situation where you need to hire for scale. So if you want to implement a new model or do another analysis, you believe that you would need to hire more resources to do so. And that is what I believe one of the most serious symptoms of being stuck in the operations swamp. You have a lack of ownership in your organization over standardization in operations. And that can be tricky, and it's often a diplomatic minefield, but someone needs to take ownership of this question. The last one is that you create a lot of algorithms, but they never end up being used in a live scenario. And that might be due to a lot of factors, of course, but one of them is that you don't have automatic operations. So there is no really nice way for other systems to get hold of the predictions that your model produces. So they are basically being stuck in the analytics platform. So before I show what I believe is the solution to this problem, I want to make an analogy of Henry Ford. And he's probably most known for the assembly line of car production. I would argue that it is still possible to build a car with 100% manual labor, where you build all parts from scratch and when you assemble all the different parts manually. But you will not be able to produce more than 1, 2, or perhaps a handful of cars a year with this method. So with an automated production line, where you utilize ready-made parts and you do the assembly automatic in a production line, your production capabilities will skyrocket. And in today's economy, if you're in the car business and you don't have an automated product line, you're out of business. So that raises the question, what would make data and analytics an exception to this analogy? I would say nothing. Nothing makes an exception. So what is then the solution? Well, innovation is required. And in our leading customers, we have seen that they are opting for different frameworks and DevOps-inspired accelerators. And these are the five frameworks and accelerators that we have identified as key. I will give you a brief overlook over the five different frameworks, but later in the presentation, we will go into a deep dive in all of these different frameworks. So the five different frameworks are machine learning framework, that is solving the problem of operations and tracking of machine learning models, but also automatic creation of data sets and training of models. The feature store is a framework for operations for and versioning and serving of features. And features are the data points that go into the machine learning model. This seems like a trivial problem, but really you can save a lot of development time with a feature store. The third one is ETL framework. ETL stands for extract, transform, and load. And that is a DevOps best practice that you use for scheduling and managing dependencies between all the different components in your data analytics pipelines. The fourth one is the A/B testing framework. Everything that you build, you would want to test to see the results of what you build. And to do that, you create A/B tests. And the A/B testing framework will speed up and standardize the automation and automate the division of customers and creation of A/B tests, as well as following up on A/B tests automatically. Last, we have the reporting framework. And this will allow for a systematic way to follow up on targets and events and standardized business metrics that is specific to your industry. And it will also focus on long-term effects and short-term effects, but also on the lift of what you're doing, not only reporting of a specific KPI, but rather how much it has increased because of what you're doing. So the economical argument for the implementation of these frameworks are the same as with the production line of building cars. And with proper frameworks, a data scientist could easily build, but also manage at least 10 algorithms. Whereas without these frameworks, you would need 5 or up to 10 people in order to build, deploy, and manage the same 10 algorithms. Of course, the frameworks are not free either. They have a direct cost in terms of licensing fees or an indirect cost in terms of resources needed for implementation. But the return of investment is so huge and you can realize it so quick that, for me at least, it is a no-brainer to implement all of these different frameworks into your organization. So before we dive into the five different frameworks and look at them in detail, I want to introduce you to a colleague of mine who will present just quickly a slight commercial for AlgoLeap trainings that we have. So if you think that algorithms and data and analytics are complex and you would like to learn more about them, you should really pay attention now. Welcome, Erik.
Thank you for the introduction, Sebastian. And hello, everyone. My name is Erik Hörberg. I'm a senior data scientist at Labs. So algorithmic marketing that Sebastian has talked about was just an experiment for a very long time. The largest companies like Facebook and Netflix, Spotify, Amazon, the fan companies, these types of companies, they can afford to run this sort of high risk experiments into what used to be this new AI thing. And then there was a big risk because the returns were unclear, the roadmap is vague, and sometimes even the use case isn't really defined. But now the personalization and the algorithmic marketing that these companies provide, that's not just something that adds some business value to that company. That's basically their entire business model. So it is clearly no longer an experiment. Now we know that AI in marketing is the future. So now it has turned into a race instead. Fortunately, it's not something that we all have to understand how it works technically in order to use it. Something as mundane as an email is actually very complicated technically, but we do not have to understand an email technically in order to use it. We just have to understand it intuitively and be able to work with it. So in the coming years, I believe that in order to stay competitive, we have to be as comfortable with our intuitive understanding of AI in marketing as we are with our current understanding of emails. There must, of course, be those that have the technical understanding. Henry Ford still needed his engineers. But when there is this bridge, a shared vocabulary between those and the rest of the organization, that's when the best business results are achieved. And that's why we created Algolib trainings packages. Please click. The Algolib training packages teaches an intuition for AI and data. So there is less focus on the technical details and more focus on practical applications. And we believe that there is, of course, a great interest into how it works technically. I studied it for 5 years, so I can attest to that. However, the starting point to learn as much as possible is to get a hold of the concepts and the vocabulary and the ideas so that you can start applying it in your daily work. Then the details will either become apparent or become much easier to learn as you're already working with it. Click. So in the training, you will learn how to apply the Data X Algo X Action Framework. You will increase the data literacy of your company, and you will also create your own first algorithm. I know that last step sounds very difficult and scary, but with all the frameworks available today, that is easily the most difficult part of the algorithm training packages. Please click. There are, of course, three different versions of this training, and it depends on what you're interested in learning. We have named them after the roles we believe are interested in the different trainings. If you want to learn something else or take several courses, don't feel boxed in by your current role. The executive level, that one focuses almost entirely on the intuitive understanding of AI. It's done in a digital roundtable format, and it will give you as a leader the right tools to future-proof your organization. Second one is a two-day online training for marketing and sales practitioners. It has group work and lectures and practical exercises. That one will give you as a marketing or sales practitioner the right tool set to apply data-driven methodologies in your daily work. Finally, the last one, it's a training for CRM and business intelligence analysts. If you want to take your data competence to the next level and learn the basics of machine learning, it's going to give you the right tool set to drive algorithm development and use case specification in your current environment. Final click. Gartner points to the data literacy as one of the most important abilities for companies today. Previous iterations of these trainings have been very well received. So if you are interested, please click and go to avals.com/algolib training where you can sign up. Now, that was my short interlude on Algolib training pack.
Thank you a lot, Eric. So the sign up is at avals.com/algolib trainings. So let's take a deep dive into the five frameworks and accelerators. I am going to get slightly more technical than the beginning of the presentation. So if you're not a technical person, please bear with me and try to see the business value that the frameworks provide instead of focusing on the technical details. The first framework is the machine learning framework. And the machine learning framework will automate all the different steps involved in training and deploying and monitoring and retraining your machine learning models. Let's say, and hopefully you have a data warehouse where you have all your data. From the data, you can remember that we had to create data sets for where the models were created or trained on. With the machine learning framework, you have this standardized so that the data sets can be created automatically. In the framework, the data set is then selected, and the framework will build automatically 10, 100, or 1,000 different models depending on what you specify. And then via cross-validation, compare the outputs of the 100 different models to pick the best performing one. And with a click of a button, you can then deploy the model. You can choose to deploy it either in batch mode, where you get scheduled predictions for a larger batch, or you can choose to deploy it as an API, where you can get live predictions. And of course, you can choose both alternatives. And when the models are applied, the results are stored via the framework. And the results can then be monitored over time to see if there is a performance downgrade or a serious shift in the features in your datasets. And if the framework detects such a shift or downgrade, it can trigger an automatic retraining of your model, which will automatically create new datasets to train on. Then it will create 100 new models, choose the best performing one, and then create a new version of the model and deploy that new version so that the new version of the model is used in every place where it is presently used today. So all in all, the machine learning framework will do automatic creation of the training data sets. It will do automatic training of multiple different algorithms with multiple different parameters. It will do automatic training validation to pick the best performing model out of the 100 ones. It will do automatic deployment, both for batch and live prediction. It will monitor results over time and trigger automatic versioning and retraining when there is a shift in features or in the performance. I would say that together with a feature store, this framework will enable your analytical unit to produce 10 times more algorithms than they would have without the frameworks. So the next framework is the feature store. And the feature store handles this tiny part here. And it seems really tiny, but it is where data scientists spend approximately 50 to 80% of the times. And that is creating features and combining them into different data sets. So the feature store will allow for faster development of these machine learning features. And it does so by standardizing the way features are created. So in this framework, you can create a feature. For a feature, you specify the code for how to calculate the feature. Let's say one feature is the number of times I visited the website the last year. Then the code will specify how to do that calculation from the data. You can specify the update interval. How often do you want this feature to be updated? Every day, every week, every month? You can also have versioning of your features. So if you want to update the calculation of your feature, you can also update the version of it to make sure that every algorithm that is using this feature is now using the new version of it. And perhaps the most important part is the historization of features. And that is whenever a feature is calculated, it is stored in the feature store. And that allows that all data scientists can use a feature that I have created. They don't need to duplicate my code or recreate the feature or even recalculate the feature, because the feature is already in the feature store and it's already calculated, so you don't have to compute it again. It's just a matter of seconds it takes to serve the feature to the one who wants to use it. And that is also what is great about the feature store, that you calculate the features slightly differently sometimes, depending on whether you do model training or if you're doing live predictions with the model. And the feature store handles this so that you as a user don't need to think about it. So the features are served in the correct way if it's a live prediction or if it's model training. Also, the feature store will handle and honor data retention in respect to GDPR. So if there is a feature and you're not allowed to store it for more than 27 months or 12 months, the feature store will of course handle that and delete all the features which are older than that period. All in all, the feature store provides a standardized way of calculating features, and all the calculations are always stored. So when you want to serve the features, they are already pre-calculated and it is really, really fast. It also has automatic serving both for batch and online requests. And with the feature store, it is super easy to just pick and choose all the features that you want and combine them into a data set, because all the features are all already here. The code is written and you can just pick and choose. I want these 50 features for my new model that I'm building. You have versioning of features, and together with the machine learning framework, this will, I promise you, it will skyrocket the number of algorithms that you can create. And it really, really lowers the threshold of just experimenting and testing a new idea. So without the frameworks, you would have to create all the features. You have a new idea, let's say, you would create the features, you would have to calculate them. And if you're working with big data sets, that might take a lot of time. Then you would need to try out different models to see which one fits the problem before you can actually see some kind of preliminary result. This process can take anywhere from 1 week to a month just to get some preliminary results. But with a feature store and a machine learning framework, you can get the same results by just picking the features you want in your data set, applying your machine learning framework on the data set, and you have your preliminary results in less than a day. The third framework is the extract, transform, and load framework. This is a framework that will handle dependencies in your data and analytic pipelines. So let's take an example that you want to calculate or produce a training data set using the feature store, of course. But the feature store and everything that you do would need to make sure that everything happens in the correct order. So before you can compile your training data set, you would need to have the features calculated. And for you to be able to calculate the features, you would have to start on the left-hand side by importing all the data that you have. Your transaction data, your customer data, product data, etc. Then you would have to clean the data and then do perhaps some aggregates on the data, then do some other transformation with the data before you end up with features which you can combine into a training data set. All the arrows in this graph indicates a dependency, meaning that this needs to happen before this can happen. And this is just for creating one training data set. And if you in your data analytics team have multiple data set, multiple models, multiple business rules that needs to be applied in a certain order, etc., you would really, really benefit from an ETL framework. I would say it's near to impossible to be able to manage and operate an analytical unit and a data science unit without such a framework. So the framework provides and handles for you the complexity of the dependencies of intertwined tasks. It will also handle the connections to systems and databases, and it will abstract commonly used and repeated code so that you don't have to copy paste code for the connection to the database or the connection to another system, but that is abstracted and provided as nice to have functions for the end user which uses this framework. This means that the user can focus on new development of new functionality rather on managing the dependencies and running things and doing basically the operations manually. So this framework, with this framework, you can easily schedule everything to happen so that all the dependencies are satisfied. You can also monitor everything. You can get this nice graph represented for you visually to see what tasks have run at what time, was there an error somewhere? And you can basically go into that where the error happened and see why it happened. And this I would estimate would reduce the resources needed to produce, but also to maintain your existing functionality by up to 90%. The fourth framework is the A/B testing framework. So everything that you build, all the models that you build, you want, of course, to deploy them and you want to test them. How much business value do they actually bring? And to do so, you typically perform A/B testing. And when you perform A/B testing, typically in organizations, I see that they put an analyst on the task of dividing the customer base into a test group and a control group. And the data of the test and control groups are then exported to the web or to the email system or to the app where the actual action is taking place. Then the test is run. And when the test is over, they put the same or another analyst on the task of analyzing the results. So the analyst will create reports, do significance testing, create a PowerPoint perhaps, and then present to the stakeholders this was the result of the test. And that is a very manual way and a time-consuming way to do it. So instead, with an A/B testing framework, you have a very user-friendly interface where you can create new tests. And for each and every test, you can specify the number of test groups, the number of customers that you want in each group. You can specify when the test is going to take place, that is the test interval. And you can also specify what metric do you want to follow up the test on. So this means that when the test is done, you get automatic reporting on the result of the test. Was the test statistically significant, or could we say with certainty that we saw a change in the metric that we measured on based on the test that we did? And this will also act as one source of truth that can be exposed to all different channels. This means that you can now create a test which is then exposed to a customer in all channels, not just the email channel, not just on web, but in all different channels. And of course, the A/B testing framework should honor a global exclusion list. So if you have a customer base, you might want to exclude 5 or 10% of that customer base into a global exclusion list, which is not allowed to be touched for testing purposes. So to summarize the A/B testing framework, it's an interface for creating and managing unlimited number of tests, where you can specify the number of test groups, how many customers you should have in respective groups, when the test should start and end. It will honor the global exclusion list, and you will have the ability to choose primary and secondary metrics. And one really important thing is the automatic check for unbiased test and control groups. Sometimes, just by random chance, you would divide the groups, a control and a test group that is actually biased. And this can happen, it has happened to me, and it happens from time to time. This means that one of the groups contains a better customer just by design. And this happens by random chance. But since you specify what metric you want to follow up the test on, the A/B testing framework can warn you that the two groups are unbiased. The two groups are biased, meaning that one group has, on average, a higher value or a lower value on the specified metric. And then you can trigger a new division of the test groups. Otherwise, if you have biased groups, it will skew the results of your test. You will, of course, be able to automatically follow up on tests after the test period. And this enables you to perform multiple simultaneous A/B tests in all different channels, I'm going to present the last framework a little bit quicker since I am running out of time. So the reporting framework will provide one standardized model for how you do your reporting on all your different use cases, on all your different metrics, and how you follow up on all different events. It will not only visualize the KPIs themselves, but also visualize short-term, but also long-term effects, and how much lift your use case have provided to a specific metric, not only tracking of the metric itself. It's also very easy to track what events are included or excluded in the different reports, and of course also easy to add new events for following up on. And the reporting framework should be utilized together with the machine learning framework so that you can report and visualize the results of your models over time and also see when to retrain models or when models were retrained. You should also utilize the framework together with the A/B testing framework to get visual reporting of the performance of your different A/B tests. Okay. That was five different frameworks. Let's combine them into one solution. This is what we call the factory approach. So in the factory approach, you would have, just as in the example in the beginning, the data to the left. You would, let's say, have an analytical platform, Google Cloud in this example, where you would import all your data automatically into a data layer. Beside this data layer, you have the layer with all your accelerators, that is the feature store, machine learning framework, A/B testing frameworks, etc. With these frameworks, you will be able to create a lot of machine learning algorithms. And the results from the machine learning algorithms, you would of course want to test. So both the results from the models, but also from the frameworks themselves, is presented in the presentation layer, which is exposed to all different activation systems. And in this way, you have the data, the accelerators, all your algorithms in one place where it's really, really easy to produce a lot of value. Okay, that was more or less my last slide for today. And I have been referring to Gartner throughout my talk. And the report that I am referring to is the top trends in data and analytics for 2021, XOps. And you can find the report and download it on our website, which is avaus.com/Gartner. Thank you a lot for listening in.
Referring back to Sebastian's notions of the operational swamp, the economical arguments for using frameworks, the competence retention, especially in the data science dimensions, and the whole structure around like the ownership of these capabilities. One thing that is very often undermined is the organizational support for these operations. And what I mean by this is that essentially you can expose an organization for a need for such change, but rarely can you actually force somebody to change. So I will build the story through three different phases, how I've observed it and how it has affected like the individual evolution as well from an organizational point of view. Now, to start the story, when we were in the data informed phase, so to say, you can see here that you have two main services. You have a plethora of different stakeholders, and what typically happened, like if we focus on the streaming platform side on the left hand side. Now, what happened was that for the streaming platform, they had a certain group of consumers that used their services, and around the streaming platform, you had a lot of stakeholders analyzing the consumers from different perspectives. Now, what happened was that all of these stakeholders started creating their own realities, so to say. So they were pretty much analyzing the same consumers through so many different objectives that basically they had their own reality. So when you think again about this whole notion of the operational swamp, and let's take as an example, we have the demographic modeling at the bottom there. What used to happen was that whenever you had a certain portfolio or a certain content concept that was published, we had to use the demographic modeling with the different data set every time. And at this point, it was only a few individuals who actually did this. So you can only imagine that whenever you try to create a reality for a service, how much more operational tendencies it gave birth to. So the need times by the operational services, whether it's done by the data analyst or the data scientist, all the way to the analysis part, and not even taking into consideration everything that has to be done at the start, which is like things like data collection and so on. So we were in a phase where we were analyzing pretty much the same data in different realities because we didn't have the capabilities to actually tie all of this in. And again, if you look at the right-hand side, the journalistic services, we had the same situation. So in the journalistic services, you had even more of these stakeholders and a lot of more of operations, which added up and stacked up in addition with the streaming platform. So this was a phase where like data collection and infrastructures were on a service level. We had multiple data structures and infrastructures. Spontaneous proofs of concepts were nearly impossible to do, and they were always based on specific data sets created within that one situation or a reality, so to say. And this was a phase where spreadsheets and Excels were king. So you can only imagine like the plethora of data that had to be gathered. Now, at this particular point, when we started looking at the how we organized around the operations, we started noticing that a lot of the operations could have been streamlined. So in a span of 8 to 12 months, we formalized everything that we did into more of a data-driven organization, so to say. So here, all of the operations, like the demographic modeling, A/B tests, everything else, was pretty much centralized. So again, when you think about on the left-hand side, we have the streaming platform. The data and the infrastructures were centralized so we could analyze the same realities at the same time, so we can give birth to common truths and realities throughout the different services. So at this point, when we think about like things like the operational swamp, it became a bit easier. However, because the organization was so big, there were still some dependencies which gave birth to, let's say, a bit clustered realities still. But mainly, if I have to describe this, like data collection and infrastructures were on a service level and they were partially like centralized. The good thing in this phase was that experiments and POCs or proof of concepts were closer to the business objectives. So again, in the previous slide, as I mentioned that they created their own realities, now we were able to create different proof of concepts on a common reality. So we're measuring the same clientele basically, or the consumer pool. And still, even though the operations were centralized, what we noticed that was that like we were missing the standardized way of doing things. So even though we had the same people, like people with different expertise under the same roof, we didn't have the technical framework or the capabilities to do so. So again, in a course to about 8 months, if I recall correctly, we became a data-driven organization and we started implementing different frameworks. So if we go forward, in this particular phase of our organizations, as you can see at the bottom, we have a lot more structure. So instead of labeling individual modelings or A/B tests under one operational task, we started clustering them under frameworks. And for each each framework, we had a separate unit actually answering for the usage of that framework. And what this basically meant was that we had specialists talking with the stakeholders and actually mapping the business needs to data. So we started growing data literacy by the stakeholders as well. And by using frameworks, let's say we have a DS services at the bottom there. We had a machine learning framework, and the framework was enabled so that the stakeholders didn't really need a specialist in between, but they could use, by using the framework, they could use automated tools like let's say from AWS, you have the SageMaker component. So they could just use the SageMaker component and actually ask for the data in the machine learning framework, whether it was like age group specific data or whatever it is. In addition, one thing that was given birth to was like this data and insight steering group. So in the previous phase, which I described as data informed, we didn't really have a unit which could have a consensus on standardization. So at this phase, we had a unit which was consisting of all of different stakeholders around the company. We had a data and insight steering group, and this data and insight steering group basically answered for the standardization as well as agreeing on a consensus on how to work in the whole data ecosystem. And how it basically worked was that whenever a stakeholder made an analysis about the consumers, they actually gave feedback on how the framework worked, no matter what the application was, but how the framework worked, and they gave the steering group the feedback, so the steering group could make additional changes on how to work or how to better the whole framework team. But what I'm trying to say here is that by using frameworks, things like machine learning services, it became super easy for us to operate on a daily level. So as you remember, this notion of an organizational evolution with the perspective of an individual, we saw immediate growth on an individual level in the competence area. So for instance, when we were talking about web analysts, typically web analysts were really, really good with the whole graphical side of things like GA and Adobe Analytics and stuff like that. But with the frameworks, we were able to actually enable competence around SQL and database languages. So whenever you have a standardized structure in place, it actually breeds, even though it's complex, it breeds a lot of competence in that sense as well. So if anything, there was a lot of economical benefits from like centralizing the computational resources through the frameworks. And like the same mundane tasks weren't necessarily done on several levels as they were done when we were in a data informed phase. It was easier. It is still easier to gather and like iterate on the operations because you always have the framework which standardized all of the operations. So no matter what the stakeholders did, no matter what data was collected on the service level, the frameworks actually kept us in check, so to say. And what this also gave birth to was this autonomy to the stakeholders. So they didn't have to wait for a specialist to actually be free of time and then give them help with like the data collection and infrastructure part. We already had automated all of those operations. So in that sense, frameworks work, and especially like in the personal like competence development side of things, using frameworks also helps that part a lot. So about the story, like there are three perspectives which tie into what Sebastian has been talking about and like the entirety of the evolution itself. So you have to keep in mind that you can't really use frameworks or change the organization to be data driven without growing the competence of the individual. So one can't really live without the other. So it's good that you realize that change is necessary, but as an organization, you have to give concrete measures to support the people to produce the change, so hence frameworks. And whenever you standardize things, things start becoming very, very easy, so to say. To the second point, again, principle. So complexity produces competence. So even though frameworks, whenever they're standardized and they are the standardized way of working within the data ecosystem, so to say, it's more than likely scary at first for an individual to start working with this, but whenever they get into this whole complex system of frameworks, as well as like using for whatever the end application is, it's easy to maintain one's guard. So this whole psychological notion of doing the algo leap is something that you should just try out. Of course, you will always have champions that do this first, but like remember that even though as complex as it seems, it will produce competence. And for the third point, I wanted to highlight the fact that standardization is key, but consensus is emperor. As you remember from the previous slide, we had a steering group. Now, you can't really standardize things without having a consensus throughout the organization. So one thing that you really should strive for is creating a consensus on how to operate in the whole framework as well as the data area. So for like form units that look at the data organization, doesn't really matter whether it's a web analyst or a data scientist. The point is that you form units that are established from different units in order to create that consensus. So anything from operations to productions in its entirety, you should form units that create consensus so that you can standardize eventually. So if anything from this case, the learnings and the observations, these are like the three key principles that you should keep in mind whenever we're talking about the framework or any data organized activities, really. I see that these three key principles have actually helped in realizing what is needed by the organization to support the individual and in order for the individual to actually produce the change eventually. But yeah, thank you for listening. I think we can hop on to the next part of the presentation.
All right. Thank you, Sebastian, Eric, and Michael for really interesting presentations. Let's see if I can. I hope you see my screen. If I don't hear anything, I'm assuming you do. So I'm gonna talk a little bit about a project that we have been working on at ICA to a large extent together with Avaus, who has provided us with experts within both data science and data engineering, which has been great. And this is a project that is actually still ongoing. And I'm gonna talk about how you can take the learnings that we have done, what we have learned while doing this project and applying it on a lot of other models as well, thus creating some kind of framework for model management. So let's see here. That was basically the introduction. So next up, some highlights and some background about the recommendation engine application that actually started off already in 2018. So what you see on the right-hand side here are what examples of different personalized marketing campaigns that ICA is sending out. It's something we call the weekly email. It's another campaign called Mina Varor, it's Hidden Rewards, it's a bunch of campaigns, and all of these are contained, and more are contained within the recommendation engine. So what ICA realized probably late 2017 was that we weren't really personalizing and utilizing all the data that we had to give our customers the best experience. So this project was started to make sure that we actually could take personalization from, at that moment, aiming a campaign or a certain offer at a segment of customer, usually a large segment, onto rather giving each household or even customer a unique combination of offers and recipes, and using all the transactional data and every other data we have collected through our loyalty program. And so that was the starting point. And this application has been developed on premise at ICA. We have a Cloudera cluster at the moment. I'm going to mention that a little bit later again, but we built a Python application basically, which of course then uses Spark for the data processing and the data science parts, and SQL as well for data processing, of course. So that is the recommendation engine. It's a large Python framework where you can do a lot of cool stuff with SQL and Spark, in essence. And when we started this in 2018, we had maybe one or two use cases, but it's actually up until now grown to something that reaches around 2.5 million ICA customers each week. So each week, something like this is sent to around 2.5 million ICA customers. And to be honest, I don't think that there are two customers that get exactly the same combination of offers, because it's so personalized, and especially when we add on the recipes that we see here, which is also it's connected to the offer, but it's also personalized in regards to what other products you typically purchase. So that's pretty cool. And today it's also the largest machine learning application we have at ICA Sweden. And we are still developing, still building new models. And this is a joint team with pretty much same amount of people from both ICA and Avaus. And it's really a nice working experience, although working remotely the past year hasn't been. It was more fun being at the office together, but we still managed to get it to work in a really good way, I would say. And what is more important, or what has come out of this is that ICA has taken a huge leap in personalization from this, as I mentioned, segment or rule-based personalization, which really didn't hit customers spot onto this framework where we really can give each customer and household what we believe is the best fit for them. And obviously, when the customer gets good offers, they will come to ICA more often, they will spend more money, that will increase our sales profit and the loyalty of the customers, since they know that they will keep getting good and fitting offers each week. So it's really a success story, and as I said, it's also the at least the largest machine learning application at ICA we have today. So that's really cool. Yeah, that is recommendation engine in kind of an overview. Looking, yeah, this is worth mentioning as well. So we started in 2018, and you can do a lot of data science in 3 years. So why is this still ongoing? Well, there is one simple, very simple reason, and that is that each week we can see that this is actually increasing the sales for the stores in, yeah, in the range of millions of Swedish crowns each week, and that is really cool. And it, I mean, if you add it up over a year or something like that, you can realize that these are big numbers, and that is of course a reason why this project is still ongoing, but also why the interest for machine learning projects at ICA is steadily increasing, because other parts of ICA see that, oh, you can make this money from data science, then, well, we want to be aboard as well. So that is, yeah, that's something worth mentioning. Next up, and this will dive a little bit deeper into how we have structured the recommendation engine. So we have the data, the raw data in, and we have information about customers, about offers, about products, recipes, and so on. So that is where we start off. Next thing is that we take this data, we work with it a lot, and then we put it into a feature store, very similar to what Sebastian talked about. And the feature store is basically just a way of making sure that if you have several models using the same feature, then you probably don't need to calculate the same feature over and over and over again. So you can do it once, and then you just refresh when you need it. But usually you can reuse the feature several times. And that leads me to the next step, which is what we have chosen to call the rec dev, or recommendation development part. And that is our models, the core and the heart of the recommendation engine. I don't know what the core of an engine is, but yeah, maybe where the combustion takes part or something like that. So here are a bunch of our models. We have more of them, and basically this framework supports us to add more and more models underneath, since we can just add the new features into the feature store. Then we have the model, and we can schedule the model to run whenever we want to, and that's really neat. And it's also gives a lot of synergies having all the models in one place. Next up is the recommendation data mart, which is the kind of where we output everything that comes from the models. And say that you have 2.5 million customers, and then you have 1,000 offers, and you want to get a score of how fitting is each offer to each customer, that would give you roughly 2.5 billion different combinations. And then you do this for maybe 3 or 4 models, say 4 models, then you have 10 billion rows of customer offer combinations, and that is a lot of data, of course. So in the next step, we have some more campaign specific logic that could be business rules, say that for this campaign, every customer should get maybe 6 offers, but none of them should be from the same category. Or it could be that in this campaign, each customer should get between 2 and 8 offers, something like that. So that is basically a way of taking the pure model output and applying business logic and business rules to narrow the results down to be consumable by the end users, which in ICA's case could be these instances. And yes, we still do have a mainframe system, it's very stable. But we also, as you can see, we have a campaign tool which manages most of our actual sendouts, and we also have exposure towards the ICA web page and the ICA app and some other use cases as well. So these are a bunch of our consumers. And what happened here as well was that this rec ops circle, or ellipse, or whatever you want to call it, occurred around it. And rec ops is our way of saying that is a kind of a team within the team that is making sure that we maintain the tools that we have, such as scheduling tools, testing tools, whatever you need to make everything within the engine run smoothly. You could consider it maybe the oil, the engine oil, or I don't know. I should stop doing these comparisons. It has shown to be a really important part, though, since through the rec ops part of the team, we can make sure that everyone is using the same tools and the same framework to build, say, a new model or add a new feature and so on. So that is a really good thing to have. That's a little bit behind the scenes. Let's see. Next up, the future and scaling up for it and generalizing. The world of machine learning is evolving. The world is evolving, and ICA is evolving. And I mentioned the Cloudera platform earlier. That is what we have today. Tomorrow, we will have the GCP platform instead, the Google Cloud platform, which, of course, and this is a journey that we have started. It will probably take a while, but in the end, it will give us a lot of new tools and new possibilities. And that will also probably make us rethink a little bit about how should we structure a data science use case, for instance, and how can we manage 50 different models within one platform in a good way, and avoid all of the problems that Sebastian mentioned earlier. And this is also something that's really, and I was mentioning it a little bit earlier as well, that machine learning and data science use case requests from the organization, we get a lot of them. since a lot of the ICA organization has realized that there is money to either save or to earn here, then machine learning is the new and hot topic of the day. So we get requests for way more work than we actually can do today. But we are recruiting, we are using consultants and so on. So we're trying to give the business at least the big value projects, and then the rest will come in the future. But still today, a lot of our projects are built in some kind of, all right, let's just get something to work. And it gets quite ad hoc. You have an individual coding style, high personal dependencies, scattered documentation, if any, and so on. And that is obviously not very good. It works when you have maybe 5 or 10 models and 5 or 10 use cases, but when you go to 50, then you need a structure. To not get lost in these temporary solutions or hacks or whatever, and also to get rid of the personal dependency, because also, again, going back to what Sebastian talked about, this person who sat there responsible only for operating the churn model. I can understand why that wasn't really the most fun part to do. I mean, as a data scientist, you want to do data science, of course. So when creating that structure, why not look at the machine learning applications you have? And in this case, for instance, you could look at the recommendation engine, which, since I've been working with it for more than 3 years, and I know that it's working well, I'm obviously advocating for taking the recommendation engine structure and turning that into a model engine. So let's take a look at how that can could look, or how that could be done. Let's see, just sneak peeking on the watch as well. Right, so this picture you saw before, this is the entire recommendation application as it is today. But if we could consider instead cutting off some parts, and that would be the more specific, the parts more specifically marketing related, like business rules and such, and then instead getting into something like this, where you have all your models in one machine learning development, swim lane or whatever you want to call it. You have one MLOps team taking care of the scheduling tools, the testing tools, and all of that for the entire company. And you have one feature store where you can have all the features that are used in all the models that you have. Then you can probably get some way. It's a nice structure, and you can probably get some really nice synergies as well, since a model developed specifically for the marketing department might as well be really useful for the replenishment department and vice versa. So and by putting everything together, then you can get these synergies to work. And in the end, it might look something like this. So you would have a bunch of sources in, you would have the feature store, we have all your company's features, you would have the model part, we have all the models in the company, you would have the model results data mart, and then two different ways to communicate or to get the results out of the data mart. One could be APIs for certain applications, and the other one could be just reading from the tables in BigQuery, because they are applications that also exists within the GCP cloud. So that would be one way of turning the recommendation engine into more of a model engine that is way more generic. Let's take a step back and think, what is really the best way to ensure consistency and maintainability when you go from, say 5 to 50 models? We know about the problem. Machine learning code is hard to maintain over time, especially if there's no structure and when you have people or projects ending, people leaving, and the number of models just growing and growing and growing. If you don't have that structure and a common way of working underneath, it becomes, I wouldn't say impossible, but really, really hard to manage. And it definitely leads to more and more time spent on operations. And what is it that data scientists and data engineers doesn't like? Well, it's definitely operations. And of course, and obviously, it's also not the best use of their competence, because they want to jump on and perform the next use case and the next use case and the next use case and so on, and build the next model for, whatever use case you might have. So how to solve this? I would suggest take a look at the products that you have within your company today. How do they work? How are they structured? Do some cherry picking. And based on that, you can probably see, okay, this is an application that's running smoothly. It produces results. It gives the business what it needs. Whereas this is a model that someone needs to manually execute once a week, and it's always a mess, and so on. So you can quite easily see on your projects that, okay, this is probably a structure that we want to keep and achieve. This is a structure that we don't want to use anymore. And by doing this exercise, you can gather the experience from the data scientists and the data engineers that has built all of this, and together with them create this common way of working and a common structure. And within this procedure or whatever you want to call it, you should also decide on what tools are necessary to centralize. It could be the feature store, a common coding standard, scheduling tools, A/B testing frameworks, model management, monitoring, data retention. I mean, there are so many topics that you can cover, and you really need to look at your company and your needs, and also the experience from your data scientists and data engineers, and of course the business stakeholders. And when you have done this exercise, try to establish some kind of MLOps Excellence Center, or whatever you want to call it, where you gather the processes and the structure and the tools, and you share it among the community of data scientists and data engineers, so that they can bring it into all of the new projects that are initiated. And in that way, you will get a way more structured approach when a new project is started. And I realized that time is running out, so I'm going to jump to my last three bullets. Some key takeaways that I really want you to bring with you from this. Number one, look at the projects you have, both the successful ones and the ones that didn't go so well. And secondly, your data scientists and data engineers, they are the experts. Don't come flashing with some management way of working PowerPoint document, because you will never ever get the people actually doing the work to use that. I'm at least 90% certain. So bring in the people that are actually doing the work into this process really, really early, at the very first stages, because then they can be a part of building this structure that you will need to be able to maintain your models in the future. Something happened, but I hope that I hope you're still with me. Let's see. Yeah, the last one. There is not one way of working to rule them all. Just make sure to find one that works for you and for your company. It could be something similar to what I've shown about the recommendation engine. It could be something completely else, but just find the method, the structure, the way of working that works for you. Start there, iterate, learn, and make sure that you use the same processes and structure for every data science and machine learning project that you do. That's it. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Martin. Thanks, Martin, and thanks, Mikael. I will take the opportunity to say some closing words. If you have any questions, you can find our email addresses in the chat. I believe that we are in the beginning of the industrial revolution of data and analytics. I hope we have provided some inspiration for you today. Talk to you soon. Bye-bye.